听青海无上师对阮世界会会员做数的开始。无上修行世界，1992年十二月，伫福尔摩沙三德门。
And we are trying to concentrate in the third eye, so many ideas come to our mind. We cannot concentrate. What could we do for try to stop this idea?
There's so many lousy thought patterns,
that's
right? The stream of thoughts, right? It's okay. Try as best as you can. Yeah, when I sit there and I want to become a real Buddha, and suddenly I think, oh, whoops, somebody just asked me this question, that question, how can I solve it for them? And then I think, huh? Yesterday I have done this, I've done that, and I haven't done well, how can I do it better today? And then, oops, come tomorrow, there's another program. So I carry on like that for a while, and I think, no, I want to become a Buddha. Oh, really, I couldn't take care of that right now. So I say, switch off, and then it switch off for a while, but sometimes the machine kaput, you know, it's out of order. You switch off, it still go on, or even like that. So you just have to put up with it, and try to fix it as much as you can. Because we always record all kind of nonsense every day, you know, even if we don't want to record, the neighbors try to record it for us, you know. You come around and say, hey, you look handsome, man. Oh, I do like your shoes. Oh, aren't they nice? Yeah. And then that's it. Your attention just go from wisdom eyes to your shoes. And you stay there for a while, you know. And it's difficult to climb up again. It's easy to come down, it's difficult to come up. So just that's how we pass our time, you know, from one idea to the next. That's why we know actually we don't have any I at all. We don't have any we at all. It's all thoughts and thoughts and thoughts. One thought after another, one moment to the next. We are not we, we are not anything. If that's what we think we are, yeah? If you think truly, if you think deeply, who are we anyhow? We are nothing, we are nowhere, we are nobody. Today we think we are happy, tomorrow we think we are miserable, and next day we think we are just neutral. And another time we want to eat that, another time we don't want to eat this. Is that we? Is that I?
No.
Is the thinking I? Is the feeling that the shoes is beautiful? Is that I? And the next day another person says your shoes ugly and you think, well, it's truly ugly. Is that the same I or not the same I?
Not the same.
Yes, yeah, so we don't have any I, no?
No.
Truly.
Yeah.
So there's no need to fix our attention to any I at all. We don't have any I. We don't have any ego. We don't have any existence as individual. Therefore, we must understand this. That's the liberation. You're already liberated. If you don't want to, that's your problem. What can I do? Understand?
Yes.
So if you think about it carefully, you know that this is truly, we don't have any I at all. We just follow one thought after another. And these thoughts, where from? Collection. Collection from left side, right side, front side, back side. From anybody. From anything that come into our focus. From any garbage, from any good or bad, anything is all garbage. You know, when you go and look at the garbage, there are some good and some bad. Yeah. It depends on your taste and your wealth, that the garbage is different from the next
house.
Yes, yes, yes. Therefore, there are some garbage collector. They come and select some what they can still use, and it's still good for them. So they collect it and collect them and bring them to their house. And maybe they sell them, maybe they use them. And that's the same thing with us. We collect garbage from the better, wiser person, properly, yes. And we think that person is wiser, more intelligent, and we collect the garbage.
Still garbage.
Still garbage. But if we're happy with it, it's okay, it's no one's business. But don't think that garbage is you.
Yes.
That is all. The secret is like that, and no nonsense. So the direct way to wisdom is like that. Realize that you are nothing, you are nowhere, you are nobody. Nobody needs you. You are nothing, absolutely. So, come back to your question. If you have any so-called garbage you keep emerging, it's because you collect too much. So, you have choice whether to throw them away completely, reject them, throw them away, or just let them lay around in your house and don't pay any attention to it. Whatever you are comfortable with, just do it.
Yeah? You told us you're a garbage collector.
Why? It's true. But I just know where to throw them. And you don't. Is it clear?
Yes.
Yeah. These things are no problem. Because we cannot help to steal the mind. So long we are still in this world. It's difficult. But it doesn't matter. Just ignore them. Ignore them. Hmm? You see, you have good shoes. Therefore, even here, we are in this so-called natural ashram. You have a lot of stones, which are very sharp. It could cut your feet, but you have good shoes. So you just walk around them all day long, and you don't care to move the stones, because there's so many, you cannot move them. Just to walk on them. You see? Therefore, our meditation is our shoes, our boots, to protect our feet. Yeah? Yeah. Just walk on all problems. Problems we still have. Stray thoughts or distractions are still there. Understand? Just ignore them. You do your thing, it thinks its thing. Yeah, the mind continues to play its records, and you continue to get in touch with a deeper level inside. And don't stop at the entrance, that is the mind. The mind always collects all kind of garbage, that is its business. If you open the walkie-talkie in the same level, same channel as other people, and you hear all kind of garbage, they're talking with no concerning about you at all. Understand? Mm-hmm. Just because our receiver, it has the same wavelength as the other person who we don't even know. That's the same thing with our mind, which collect the so-called karma. This is garbage. Yeah, because we collect other people's problems, other people's ideas, other people's feelings. Therefore, sometimes suddenly we just feel miserable and we don't know why. It's because your transmitter opened. And then you just suddenly receive some nonsense. Something has nothing to do with you, but you overheard it. Understand? And then it has some impression on your mind. And that's what it is. And if we still cling to that feeling or that idea, and slowly it becomes yours, it becomes ours. We possess that, and then we feel the same like the person who sends it. And that's what we call collective karma. We just suddenly overheard somebody is dying or somebody is loving somebody and he's leaving her and she was crying over the walkie-talkie. And then you suddenly also feel very bad for her, and then you just feel that feeling all day long, or 2-3 days or even longer, then you're in trouble. So it just has to be alert and pick what you want.
and feel what you want to feel and reject what you don't want to. Yeah? If you think the receiver keep receiving somebody's garbage, just turn it off. Or ignore it. Don't listen to it. Don't listen to it. Therefore, sometimes in life, we cannot avoid to feel lonely, to feel miserable, or to feel lovesick, or to feel whatever the situation. But we just don't bother. Okay, I know I'm miserable, and that's finished. That's it. I still go on with my job. Understand? Any ordinary mind, the same. My mind, the same. But I put it under control. After I know that it doesn't like the way it looks, I say, all right, I know you don't like it. We arrange it the other way. Understand? But I cannot stop it when it reacts. Understand? I can stop afterward. When it reacts like this, it let it react like this. But then I try to make it up. Understand? I don't follow the reaction to the end. And I don't follow the dictation of the mind. That is all. That's the difference between control and uncontrolled. Understand?
Yes.
Because the mind, it follows its pattern. It's just a machine. It's just a kind of a computer. Whatever you record in, it will react the same way. So there is no flexibility within the computer. You understand? The flexibility comes from the person who controls the computer. It's we, the soul, the source of knowledge, the awareness, the wisdom. That is we. Yeah? So therefore, you see the two different persons. The one who react angrily, that is the mind. Okay? That is the so-called we, that we collect all kind of reaction. That in that situation, we have to react like that, because the mind used to react like this in so many lives. So it reacts the same way. It's difficult to change it right away. The data has to be erased, and some other thing has to be arranged. But then it collected so many from other people, from seeing, from hearing, from television, from everything. So it reacts the same way like everybody else. Understand? You cannot easily erase it. Except that we meditate a lot every day. Yeah. But still, sometimes we collect more than we can erase. So we have trouble. Right? We probably have less trouble than the person who doesn't erase his machine. But we don't have absolutely free of trouble. Because it keeps collecting all the time. Understand?
Yes.
You cannot avoid seeing things when you have eyes. And when you want to close it, then you don't see anything. Yeah. But if you open it, even though without wanting to see, you will see, oh, that person beautiful, that person ugly, that person long face, that person short leg, etc. Yeah, you cannot avoid to see. Therefore, our mind is the same, because it has an open door, 24 hours, looking, seeing, hearing, smelling. These are the doors to collect information, and it keeps collecting whatever you want or not want. And it reacts the same way, in the same pattern. You understand? Yes. Now, therefore, the difference is that is the one person, so-called person, which is reacting like a machine, understand? In the same situation, it reacts the same way. But there's another person who behind it, control it, understand? So in this case, you don't react like that. Or you react like that, okay, but I change. That is we. That's the wisdom. I understand. Otherwise, if we continue to follow the so-called I that acting and reacting every day, that is not the true one. And so we don't have that. Understand? We don't have really a true I. We have all the wisdom. And in the wisdom, everyone reacts the same. Means we do whatever we must in different situations. But the mind do similar thing even in similar situation all the time. No flexibility, no exception. No allowance, no tolerance. Understand? So you understand how to control your mind? I tell you what to do. When you meditate and your mind wants you to go and drink coffee, then you tell them, yes, I will give you coffee, but after meditation, that's all. And if it wants you to go and find your girlfriend, say, okay, later, after 2.5 hours. That's it. No need to against it, no need to fight it and struggle and waste all your energy. Just tell them later I will give you, not now. Just say, it's just like you control a dog or you control a child. You understand? Because a child may be very lovely. It's very decorating for your life. But you cannot always listen to the child. It wants to go to the park. It wants to go seesawing. It wants to go to the seaside. It wants to eat candy all the time and don't want to eat the main meal, etc. You cannot always listen to the child. Doesn't matter how much you love it. Understand? The same thing. Our body needs something. Our mind will react. Understand? Probably the stomach hungry and the mind say, now you have to go and put something into it. Because that's a habit. The machine knows when to put something in and when to put something out. We already put that information inside. But the difference is that we say, now I don't have time. Are you hungry? Okay, but later I give you. Yeah. That's all. That's the difference, okay? And then the mind will be quiet. Be friend with it. Don't go against it. You cannot always listen to the child. Doesn't matter how much you love it. Understand? The same thing. Our body needs something. Our mind will react. Understand? Probably the stomach hungry and the mind say, now you have to go and put something into it. Because that's a habit. The machine knows when to put something in and when to put something out. We already put that information inside. But the difference is that we say, now I don't have time. Are you hungry? Okay, but later I give you. Yeah. That's all. That's the difference, okay? And then the mind will be quiet. Be friend with it. Don't go against it. It's just like you blowing your nose when it's cold, or you eat something when you're hungry. If you're truly hungry, how can you meditate? Instead of struggling, you can struggle for so long only. But if every day you're struggling, every moment you're struggling, that's no good. You spend all your energy in that direction, and you cannot concentrate anyhow. I tell you to put your mind at ease and say later, 1 hour later or 2.5 hours later. But I don't say to you every day and every hour you don't give your stomach anything. Understand? It's only temporarily postponed. And later you have to satisfy it if you truly need it. Each one has different desire and needs according to previous collection of information. Or the impression from the environment. Therefore, if we truly cannot uproot some desire, then just satisfy it. Understand? And then after it's finished, then we still have time and some left energy to continue with our practice. Otherwise, we spend all our energy. And we have none. We have nothing. We have not even meditation. When you meditate, you only think of that. Yeah? I know some disciples who read some kind of books about fasting. It's all right to fast if you want to, if you're too fat, if you're too lazy to move, if you eat too much, then just half fasting. Maybe control a little bit of your palate, yeah? Maybe eat 80%, 60%, something like that. Or maybe fasting a few days, all right. But somebody fasts, and then what they do? They go and look at the recipes book all the time. Somebody told me like that.
He don't look at the practicing book, meditation book, whatever. He don't look, he just keep looking and buying recipe books and read everything. He cannot eat with the mouth or eat with the eyes. So what's the use? Understand? And I guess when he meditates, he only think of recipes.
Like when people die, they talk about how they see the lights and things like this.
Yes.
Is a good meditation somewhat on that same level? A high level?
Higher than that. Higher than that. Because sometimes we still feel the surrounding. You understand? And we are at the same time in another level. We are not totally disconnected with the body sometimes. And sometimes we are. Sometimes we are. We are absorbed in the light and we don't know anything else. Yeah? And then somebody, for example, somebody see the master inside, and they thought the master just walk in their house. Understand? In fact, it's not so. They will rise up to a different level. Yeah, like that. But the death experience is not necessarily a high level. They might see light, they might hear sounds, but it's not a higher level.
Depends on how high they were when they, before they die.
Yes. And when we meditate,
It's similar to that, but you cannot say always the same. Hmm? Because we meditate, our body and soul is still connected with each other by an invisible cord. And when we're dead, it's cut off. Understand?
Lately I was depressed very much, so I had problems with meditation, with everything. What to do if your body refused to function even? And it's so hard that even you cannot meditate. Although I was meditating like 6 hours daily or even 8 hours daily, I didn't have results like before.
Understand.
After the initiation, when I was at ease, and meditation brought me a lot of satisfaction and happiness.
Yes.
And I couldn't get it recently.
Not now.
Not now.
Yeah. Well, this is called the winter of the soul.
For so long.
When everything is dark and cold, miserable, no green, no light, no sunset, nothing. Absolutely terrible. Everybody has to go through winter sometimes. I tell you what, just be patient.
Oh,
pray, that's all there is. Yeah? And also look after our environment and our diet and the books that we read, the people that we associate with. It could be that we are too involved with someone else's problem, too sympathetic to someone else's situation, and that will also act as a bridge between you and that person, and you have to share the half of what that person is carrying in his heart. Yeah, sometimes it's like that. We cannot avoid, we cannot always walk through life without any hindrance and any effect from the neighbors. But that needs practice. That's why we have to practice. Otherwise, we have initiation and then we're finished. Nirvana. We have to share our merit with the whole world. That's why we have trouble. The road we walked, the people who make the roads for you, the people who cook the food for you, the people who plant the field for you, they all have to share your merit. It doesn't mean you are initiated now, that all the debt you don't want to pay. This life debt, we have to share. Therefore, whoever we are in connection with, whatever we use of this world is not free of, not free of charge. Hmm? Sometimes we change the environment and we feel different. Suddenly our practice dropped, because we're not used to with the atmosphere of the surrounding. Understand? So slowly you will gain foot there. Just like when you open a new business, you're not accustomed with it. The customers don't know you, and the competition is very high. Not like the way you stay. People know you. Understand? And you know how to go where about with your business. It's the same. It's sometimes different. When I travel, sometimes I feel different. I feel more run down. Yeah, when I sit in the airplane with full of people, but it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. I just know it. That's all. Yeah, I don't choose so much. I just go where I like to go, and I feel good. Understand? Yes. So just carry on with it. I'll try to help you. All right. Anywhere you go, be sensitive. And make the right choice all the time. Don't be affected by other people. If you feel something is wrong, you have to immediately collect yourself, yeah? And protect your own
environment, huh? Your own atmosphere.
Mm-hmm. Mm, okay. Since you have so free choice and no pressure inside.
Free choice is most difficult.
Yeah. So you make your own choice, okay?
Okay, thanks.
Why should I make your life decision, huh? Some people even come to ask me whether they should marry that person or this person. I say, it's your business. You who I love them. How do I know?
Why should I tell you to love this person and forsake that person? How do I know? What for? Huh? When you say is the master know everything about karma, understand? Yeah. And when since I know, then karma is cannot avoid. So why should I bother? What cannot be avoidable? It will happen anyhow. So why should I point my finger and say this and that and others? It will happen by its own. When you cannot bear something, you have to want it. You want it absolutely. You must have it. Then you will have it. Doesn't matter what I say. Is that not so? So somebody just make a kind of, I'll say, lottery. they make a coin, you know, and ask the master to decide something. But when, for example, I say the face is yes and the other is no. And when the face is up, supposed to be yes, and that contrary to their wish, then they make it again. They make it maybe 100 times until the master agrees with them finally. So what is the use? They are laughing. They know it. Yeah, they know it. They know what I say is true. Yeah. Understand? So I love the master, it's okay, but I do what I want. It's always like this. So just do what you want. Do whatever you feel absolutely good about it. Yeah? Or maybe that you feel better than the other choice, then do it. Take the risk. Be responsible for your action and your life. And pray to God for him. But do it. Right? You have to eat when you're hungry. You don't pray to God to eat for you, no? So why make trouble with any other things? For example, I take care of my life too, even though I have many people take care. But in my handbag, I have all the things that necessary for survival. For one or few days. Understand? One pair of clothes, scissors, small knife and all that kind of thing. That I might keep warm at least. Hungry is okay for a few days, but get cold and like that is no good. Understand? Mm. So, and then inside my bag there's a small sleeping bag. Very small, very thin one. That is supposed to be like a tent, you understand? You cover it, yeah, and it's at least keep you warm. You won't freeze to death. And very light. It's about 1 hour or 2 hours. Yeah, this kind of thing. Because I cannot carry a sleeping bag anywhere, but at least I survive. You understand? If my temperament should move me around alone, then I'm alone. Because if you depend on people, you have to wait for them. You know? You have to trust yourself. Hmm? Mm. Learn to rely on your wisdom. Take risk. And learn by mistakes. That's how you grow. Always wait for a master to make decision for you. That's nonsense. That is not surrender. Understand? That is dependence. And that's debt. That's not progressive. You make your decision and pray to the master. Understand? Yes. Or pray to the master that I make the right choice. And if I don't, maybe because I didn't get the message clear, I make it again. It's very easy, no? Have fun with it. Have fun with your mistakes. Have fun with learning. There's nothing to lose. Life is always dangerous. It ends always deadly. And nothing else more dangerous than life. What else do you fear? Hmm? We live dangerous life, no? We end deadly. Always ends deadly. We die at the end anyhow. Have fun, huh? So laugh and don't be miserable. If you cannot meditate, then don't meditate. If you have no experience, then you don't have any. And you have none. So what? Huh? What can you do about it? Huh? Yeah, you've done your best and you should be satisfied with your own effort. That is the result. Despite all this dry winter, cold night, you still meditate. And that's the best reward already. You understand? Your mental strength. That's the best reward. If everything's always smooth and you always carry on, what is the use? What is the measurement of your power?
your willpower, understand? Be happy that you have nothing and you still continue. That's incredible. Understand?
Yes.
That's true love. If you love somebody and he loves you back and he always treats you nicely, what is the big deal? Huh? True love is you forgive him, forgive all the time, and you always love him whatever he does. This is true love, unconditional. Understand? So be happy with that. You have to look at the positive side. Why always looking for experience? That's garbage. Experience is in the non-experience. That is your best experience.
If I sit for a minute and I have nothing, I go and eat soup.
I say, okay, forget it. And I eat soup afterward and I go walking and I do something else. And then later I meditate again. If it doesn't work again, then I do something else. Yeah? So if it doesn't work, it's alright, I've done my best.
I have the same experience. I just want to contribute, and I don't know if it will help or not. But I was feeling very depressed, and I couldn't do anything. It's the same situation. And I decided just to sit and cry for a couple of hours.
You feel even better.
Then I felt much better. And that night, during my sleep, Master came and comforted me. So, and then after that, I got back in shape. So, and another way I do to solve my problem, if I have a problem, I just sit and meditate on it until I'm clear in my head what to do about the problem.
Right. Or just do it and take the risk. Pray to the Master, say, I don't know what choice is the best, I just pick one. So you guide me.
Yeah.
Understand? That's it. This, which one do you feel the most, understand, comfortable, like that? Otherwise, how do we do? Of course, meditate is the best. But you have so much problem, you cannot meditate 24 hours. Right? Each problem needs about 4 hours to solve. And then you have the next coming. And then you don't have to do anything. Just sit there and meditate all the time on problem. You know, the silent tears. I write everything about you because I have gone through. And sometimes I stamp my feet. You don't see?
Yes.
I say, all right, if you don't come, then you don't come. Go anywhere you go. Don't bother. All right?
I'm fed up.
Finished. Yeah. And then the Master come. Understand? Yeah. So like sometimes you quarrel with your wife and your husband and you don't talk to each other. Yeah. And you know, sometimes you know you're right. And that person knows also, but she doesn't come. And then you just ignore her and then she come.
Yeah.
She come around. Right? Yes. The Master is not that unreasonable, you know. After all. Supposed to be very, very reasonable, very sweet person. But sometimes we cannot see, we cannot feel because we are obstructed by something. Understand? That is all. We have to go around. For example, we are meditating now on the riverside, right? And sometimes you could walk straight very fast. But then because the straight way is not easy because there are big blocks of stones or something like that, so you walk around. It takes a longer time. That's all. Looks like you don't move forward, but you are forward. Understand? Yes. Well, we just have to walk around. Winter nights seem long, but it never lasts. It doesn't last forever.
I also like to go and stay in an ashram to work for some time.
If you're clear, you know that you don't make trouble for yourself while you were there. Understand? If we want to stay in the ashram, it's all right. But we have to be clear of responsibility. Understand? Because that is a place for rest and meditation. If we bring this kind of mundane problem into it, it's not correct for the people who live there. That is all. Otherwise, everyone's welcome. Understand, huh?
Yes.
We should try to keep our social responsibility in order to keep our group going.
understand, for the sake of us and everyone else. That is all. Nothing else I ask of you. Hmm? Anytime you're welcome in any ashram, be sure you're clear and clean. At least the outer responsibility, or inside, I cannot help you. I cannot ask you, because if you're absolutely clean, then you don't need me. And you don't need the ashram, that's for sure. But at least the outside. Are you understand?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes,
thank you.
I understood with the mind that we don't have an I. We don't. Our feelings are not us, and our thinking are not us, and so on.
Right.
So what is the thing that goes from one reincarnation to another, and what causes karma and collected, and what causes merit and collected? Mm-hmm. Is it our mind who?
Our mind.
Okay.
Yes. And our mind, and our soul that cling to that mind. Understand? For example, the car goes wrong and the driver doesn't jump out of the car, then he get done with, together with the car. Hmm? If he jump out in time, if he doesn't feel attached too much to the car and trying to save the car, then he might save his life. Okay? Some people love the car more than their life. Yeah, that's the same trouble with most of us. We love our garbage collector more than our soul, more than our real self. We're always in touch with the outside world, with the collecting thought, with all kind of preconceived ideas, with all kind of nonsense, but we're not in touch with our real Lord, our real self. Hmm? So we have trouble. Hmm? If in our life, you understand who's living now? The awareness. Understand? The real I that is living through the perceiving agents of the hands, the feet, the eyes, the ears, the mouth, the feeling, the brain. Understand? That's it. And should I, this awareness, always get stuck with these feelings, with these thinking, with these informations, then the I cannot be free from the feeling, from the thinking, from the preconceived collecting ideas of the society, of the environment, of the habit. And of course, that true awareness, this true I, have to come back again. Should this true I always understand that he, the true I, the true awareness, is only the witness of all these feelings, of all this thinking, of all this collecting thought, then this I never gets stuck with this feeling, never gets stuck with these ideas, and is always free. So when he dies, he knows absolutely he is not this feeling, not this binding, not this surrounding, not these ideas. Then he's free. He merged back to the whole river of life, and not get stuck to that corner of so-called thinking, feeling, and hate, and love, and all that. Understand? So we have to awake our awareness again, pull it back, and keep reminding all the time, you are not this feeling, you are not this idea, you are not this, you are not that. Understand? Nothing is you.
Same with pain?
Yeah. Pain because the body feels pain, because the nerves feel pain. The nerves is made to feel things. Yeah? And the awareness, enjoy this feeling. Enjoy to know outside things. Otherwise, how can we be aware? This is the awareness. Understand? That experience pain through the body. But the awareness itself has never pain. If you eat an apple, it's the apple that is sweet. It's not your tongue that's sweet. Not you who are sweet. The sweetness is not you. It's from the apple. And the you are the one who enjoy the sweetness. For example, so like this, same similarly, we ourselves, the awareness, enjoy the pleasure, know the pain, and reject the unpleasant things. But all these things, it doesn't matter. Okay, you enjoy it or you reject it. you experience the unpleasant or pleasant, but that's it. But you are not the pleasant or unpleasant. These are only circumstances. So why should you get stuck there? And be bound, like after life. Because you're not satisfied. Huh? You have to know that these things are fleeting. Today it comes, tomorrow it goes. Okay, that's it. If I have joy, I enjoy it. If I have unpleasant things, and I endure it. And that's it. And when I'm gone, I'm gone. When I don't have them, I don't have them. Otherwise, if we, the awareness, keep chasing after pleasure, then you reincarnate. The awareness trying to catch the last leftover feeling. So try to put itself into a frame again and enjoy or suffer. Always clinging to this sweet or bitter feeling. Understand? Chasing after them. Okay, one more again. If we have an apple, somebody give you an apple and you eat it, oh, you love it so much, and now you don't have another one. Now you go everywhere searching for an apple. Then every day your mind is only apple, 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 and you cannot do anything else, and you lost yourself. Understand? You lost yourself in the sweetness of the apple. The same thing with our life. The awareness, chasing after pleasure, and hating the unpleasant. And we get stuck there. And the awareness cannot free itself from this feeling. Therefore, we are bound. We're not liberated. If we know that every moment, and that especially at the time of death, that we are not this feeling, we don't care about this feeling, and we have done without this feeling, then we are free. We are always free. We have never been unfree. Understand?
Yes.
So cry when you want to cry, laugh when you want to laugh, but understand the crying and the laughing is not you. You just experience it. So for the sake of knowing things, for the sake of existence. Otherwise you don't exist. Otherwise the world doesn't exist. Understand? Okay, we say the world is full of suffering, it shouldn't exist, but why shouldn't it exist? Right? Why shouldn't it exist? If it doesn't exist, also boring. Nothing else to do. Are you enjoy all the time? Oh, I am that, I am that. I am that. I am that, I am God. That's it. I'm almighty. I know it. I have no suffering, nothing. I'm always blissful. And so what? Understand? You don't bother about nirvana. So what? Understand? If you're happy every day, so what? But because you still want nirvana, so work for it. Work until you don't want it anymore. You're fed up with it and then you're free. I only want you to work to nirvana because I want you to know that you don't need nirvana. Understand? But as long as you need it and work for it, then work for it. If you still want the dummy, the plastic one, then just have it. But you have it until your mouth dry and have no milk and nothing, and then one day you throw it. Understand? And realize that you don't even need it in the beginning. Because you're always free of that. You don't need that. Yes, sir.
Please tell me how to relax our physical body.
You don't know? How do you relax when you, how do you sleep? Huh? Just like that. How do you sleep? Do you cling to something? Or you hold on to something? Or you hold on to microphone? Or you hold on to your pen or something? No, you do something tragically? Just like when you go to sleep. Yeah? Put everything out. Now you rest. Understand? Just tell your mind you're going to rest. And that's it. Don't think of anything, no business, no phone call, anything. Everything have to wait until after meditation. And then when your mind rests, your body rests. Huh? Just like when you go to sleep. And you sit there, and just like you go to sleep, but you don't sleep. That is all. Okay? And if you do sleep, then you sleep. It happens. It happens. Do some exercise if you don't have a lot of exercise. It depends. If you feel restless, then take some deep breath, understand? And do some exercise in movement according to what you like. And then move the body like this, like that. Mm-hmm. And kicking around.
do some gymnastics, understand? And that's it, and then you sit. Walk a little bit, wash your face so you are awake, yeah? And just like go to sleep, except you keep your attention in your wisdom center and don't sleep. Understand?
Yes, I understand.
Okay. You want to visit me only, right?
Yeah, I don't know, because we afraid of tension that boy for before I was born. Then the first time he see your picture and he kiss your picture very, very much every night, over 10 times per day. Then after that, he saw you one time, and after he come back home, and he say he want to come back home. And he say, where your house? You are, you say, he say,
master
his house and master house. Yeah. And master play. Then until every day, about 4, 5, 10 days, more 10 times per day. Then until I have a change come over here, and I keep secret because I don't want he know. Then I wait until the day before I left, and I received my airplane ticket, and he hold that airplane ticket. He said, oh, mom, congratulations, that's airplane ticket. You go see master. And I very surprised. Yes. And he said, oh, mom, congratulations, you go ahead to work, don't worry. And I stay home, you be good boy. But as a master, when I come back home, he come over with master, that's the question he want me answer. And he say, you don't answer, only master answer for me. I wait at home, I will be good boy. Thank you, master.
How do you answer if you were me?
Because I am not master, so I don't answer.
The one boy in Hong Kong want to see me, another girl in Thailand want to visit me, another boy in Canada want to become a monk, and another boy want to see me. What shall I do? Tell him to stay home and see the master inside.
Yes, I told them, and you still you're young, you stay home.
All right. So tell him just be a good boy and wait until time comes.
Yes.
I don't know when. Whatever God arranged, it will come. All right?
Yes. Thank you very much, Master.
Tell him whenever God arranged, then he can come. We both have to wait, me and him. Children, I don't know why they love me so much.
Wonder.
Yeah, many people tell me, oh, my son, I don't know why he always miss me. Say, oh, he miss Master so much. Hey, Master is his mommy. I am not his mother. Yeah, in Hong Kong, in Thailand, in anywhere. All the children. And they don't know nothing about Dharma. Do you know? I don't know if they're older or the younger. They just love me so much and surprise the adult. Theosophy, you understand, about theory, and they know nothing. I just love the master, pure and simple, unconditional, and that's beautiful, huh?
Yes.
But what shall I do? If I go around and visit all the children that love me, I never have time for you, the parents. That's the trouble.
I feel that you are trying to experiment with trying to be more like a human and have us see you more as a human being rather than a master all the time.
I don't really know what I want you to do. It depends on situation and depends on that person. If it's too much clinging to a notion of being a master and this and that, and master has to be like this and that and other, I say don't be so tense, understand? Just look at me as your friend. I'm one of you. Do you understand?
Yeah.
And if some person look at me in such a so much a mundane way, now you tell them, remember, I'm a master. So
that means we can't talk about football and
You can. But I'm not interested in football as a problem. But if you want to, if we have time, I talk about football. You know, I don't know nothing about football, but I can talk about football. Yeah. You know what? If we are together, one or two person, yeah? And we chat together, and I talk about anything that interests you. You know, I play chess, and I play pianos, and it's just like you. Yeah, and I talk about chess, and I talk about all kind of other hobbies, and I draw. In that aspect, I'm very near to you. Yeah, drawing is like playing football, no? One of the hobbies. Yes. So if you want to talk about football, go ahead. But I'm afraid other people don't want it, so it depends on circumstances.
You're a master, and we're the disciples. And yeah. Like in the real world, we're sort of like masters. While if we go out and teach people,
yeah,
and they'll look up to us, they'll love us, and they'll respect us and everything. But it's hard for me to be humble sometimes.
Yeah, I understand.
And how do you
adjust,
that?
Right?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. How do you do it so that you're humble, but they don't feel that you're arrogant?
With whom?
Anyone. If for example, sometimes someone looks at me, and because I'm practicing on this path, they think, they see something in me.
Understand.
And they
mention, respect you, yes.
Yeah, they respect me, but I want them to respect themselves.
Yes.
Instead of respecting me, don't worry about me.
Yes.
And I feel that it's difficult to tell them that.
Yes.
And at the same time, not be arrogant, not be teaching them. I don't want to teach them. I want them to teach themselves through their own experiences.
Let them introduce them
Excuse
to
me?
The Kuan Yin method. Introduce them the way to know themselves, like the way you know yourself.
Yeah.
That's no arrogant. That's no arrogant. It's just helping.
I feel my ego goes up.
Yeah.
When they praise you, right?
When they praise me.
Well, that's unavoidable.
that's just the garbage coming, right?
Oh, never mind. Just know it, that's enough. If you know it, that's already cured. You don't even want to eat. You don't even want to teach people. Sometimes I keep a little bit ego in my pocket and take it out and chew it if I need them. Otherwise, I don't want to see you. I often don't want to see anybody. I don't want to teach anybody. I don't want to do anything. What for? I'm absolutely satisfied. With doing nothing, or with doing anything, or without anybody. But because you want to see me, it's all right. I don't want to see you, but I have to try to choose something in order to see you. Or I make up, or I wear some nice clothes, or make an excuse to come.
Yeah, there are many situations when I feel I'm perfectly happy in that situation.
Yeah.
But then when in my heart, if I feel that something is wrong, should I try to tolerate it and be patient, or should I try to suggest an alternative in a loving way? Or...
Yeah, suggest alternative.
And if they don't accept it, just let it be.
Mm. Always try our best in any circumstance to improve the situation. Surrender doesn't mean passive. Doesn't mean inert passivity. Understand? We are living. We are experiencing. We are improving. We have to always control the situation in our best way. Not that we want to control people, but we control the situation and make it better in our power. Understand? If we cannot, that's all right. Yeah, we never know who is better, who is not. Maybe in our own way, we think we are right. And that person in his own way, he thinks is right. So we don't clash. Huh? All right. So whatever you want to do, if you think it's right, doesn't hurt people, do it. Hmm? Pray to the master.
Okay, right. I'm praying to you now.
Since you're right here.
All right. Sure, you can. You're also my disciple, no?
Yeah.
Are you connected with me, aren't you not?
Yes.
No. Yes.
Yes.
So you don't have to say you do it. It's Master who does it.
Yes.
So no problem. You're never away from Master, no? You have to answer them. It's not I who do it, it's a Master. So they have nothing else to say. Understand? The convenient method you can teach people, but be sure that that person is sincere and interested and needed. Have to use intuitive understanding, never ego. The new initiates or new practitioners tend to have a very urgent need to share this good news with everybody. Because we're good. We feel good. Why don't you have it, man? This is so good.
Yeah, and we try to force vitamin on a healthy person. Yes, understand? Therefore, we have to control ourselves first.
Not that we don't want to teach people, but we have to understand where we go and our ego. It plays our tricks.
And that is where we should be careful. Understand? It's easier to teach people
it's difficult to handle our desire. That's still a mundane desire. Understand? You have to understand that what makes progress, what makes spiritual benefit is the real self awaken and wants it. The seeker is the seek, is the thought. You understand? That is when God Himself wake up and want to have His own position again. Then it works. Because then my God will talk to His God, and the God will mix together. Like baby, you cannot force solid food on them. Then you're in trouble, and they are in trouble. And you soon get disappointed, and you want nothing to do with human being again. That is all, okay? Whoever you want to teach, teach. But remember that.
You know, the Americans, as we all know, have a different cultural background.
Yes.
Different concepts about religion, spirituality.
Yes, I understand.
All of the support literature that we have is written more from the Asian perspective. You know, things such as the Supreme Master Ching Hai, which is beautiful, but to the unaware American who just reads that on the street, he would think, well, this teacher is full of ego.
My father is the Supreme Master. I take the name after him. Okay? Ching Hai is only the name of my body, of my ordination. Supreme Master is my family name. Family name. My surname. My surname is the Supreme Master. So are you. But if you don't want to take it, it's all right. I take it. My father has the same name. Why should I take another name? Jesus Christ. Christ means the Supreme Master. Mean God Almighty. Mean God Power. It's the same meaning. Guru means the same meaning. Guru means the light giver. The light giver is the light itself. Only the Supreme Master can give light. So Guru means the same as the Supreme Master. If I am not the Supreme Master, I don't teach you anything. I don't want to teach you ABC, I don't want to teach you garbage. I can only teach you the Supreme thing. And the Supreme Master can only teach the Supreme thing. If you want to look for the unsupreme thing, undergraded things, then you look elsewhere without the Supreme title. Understand? If you want to see a doctor, you have to go with see the one with the doctor title. If you want to see any nurses, it's all right. But you don't make the doctor change his title to suit you. Understand?
Yes.
Because there are other people who like to look for a real doctor. So if they want to look for a Supreme Master, they see me, they see my title, they say, that's it, I want this one. Yes. And so I'm speaking to these supreme looking people.
Guru Brahma, why they call Brahma? Because he's a supreme.
Yes, that's right. You say, Guru is Brahma, Guru is Vishnu, Guru is Shiva, Guru is God, Guru is everything.
That means supreme.
Yeah, that's right. If I'm not the Supreme Master, then I don't have to teach you. I don't want to teach you anything less than the Supreme. Because you want to look for the Supreme, no?
Yes.
Yes.
Hmm?
Yes. I came from the Supreme. I'm born from the Supreme. I take the name after the Supreme, and I am the Supreme. I am and the Supreme are one. Now, if anyone doesn't accept that, that means he doesn't want to accept himself. He denies his own glory, and that's his own right. Understand? I have nothing to force him to do it, to accept his own glorious title. But I accept, and I invite you all to accept it. Now, accept himself.
Yes, my question is,
yes.
It's not about this, it's something different, but
yes.
It's really important,
yes.
I think.
Yes.
My question also is not mine, from many initiates in Panama.
Yes, yes.
We have been hearing in Panama some information many months ago, also by the Catholic Church,
yes.
And many people talk about 3 days of darkness that will come to the earth. And we should be they are given a list of things and
what to do and what don't.
To do and what to get to be prepared for this day
of darkness.
And, and they say message, they publication message of the Virgin Mary and Jesus Christ talking about these 3 days. Mm-hmm. So I want to know if we should really pay attention to this information.
We should always be prepared. Because not only 3 days of darkness come, every day is darkness, as long as we are not in the light. Yeah? But now that we are in the light, we don't need to be prepared for darkness.
But they say that during these days you cannot go out of from your house or the place you are, because in the atmosphere it would be some kind of particles.
Understand. That harms you.
And we should have a curtain.
Close.
To don't see outside.
Close and all that. Uh-huh.
Things like that.
Well, let's see, huh? When it comes, then you will know what to do. Because I would also advise you not to go out when it's all dark outside. It's dangerous. If nobody goes out, why should you go out? What for? With whom? To see whom? Everything shut down, everything dark? Then I would advise you to stay home and meditate. And that's the only preparation necessary. No, don't you think? If it's all dark and nobody goes out, why should we go? We'll see what happens, okay? You act according to circumstances. And since it doesn't come yet, why worry? And when it comes, you will know. No? Okay.
Yes.
Let's see. Huh?
Thanks.
Yes.
Panama, all every day,
there are
message
it.
Of the predictions. And even there is a father of the Catholic Church who from Chile. He called to Panama because in Chile there is a lady who see the Virgin Mary, and she have a message for Panama that a big
earthquake and that coming
something like that will happen very soon. So for people prepared for that, and so people always is taking care of that because people don't want to things surprise them.
Understand. I don't know anything about the future. I take care of today. That's enough. In the Bible it says the same. Worry you not over tomorrow, because today is enough. If you are Catholic, you listen to the Bible. Don't listen to nonsense. No? That's a guideline. Yeah? So, all right? I don't say anything unorthodox. It's true, huh? So take care of today only, and if you die, you die. If you don't die of earthquake, you die of other things. Life is dangerous, I told you already. It ends deadly. Always ends in death. So we cannot prepare so much. Don't you know most of people die in bed more than in any other accidents? In the safe house, in bed and in between the safe walls. Okay? Everything in life is risky. If we truly seek the truth, we don't mind any surrounding. If you so blindly search for the truth, then God will reward you. If you still look for surrounding and people and race, then God helps you. I cannot.
Just few minutes. I have one experience I want to share. See, my husband, he is American also. When he after he get initiation, he came to the center.
Yeah.
I think if you go to the center and you feel that just the center, you go for meditation, not because go in there to look for somebody treat you this way or do this way or what happened.
Okay, that's very good, very good. Okay, now you told me about this. I remember my previous experiences. I went all over places. I meditate with all kind of people. And I live in the ashram of the ashram next to the railway. I never see anything. accept my own destination. I only see myself. I only see what I have to do and nothing else. And I was so busy doing my own things. Yeah? I was too busy cleaning up the ashram in India. And I was also busy doing my own, you know, understanding and thinking and running inward. And I was too busy enjoying my samadhi. My leg got numb, my arms numb, my whole body is not there. How else can I see anybody? I am not even there. I'm gone. Yeah, that's the best way to go to any ashram. If you believe in that master, just go to the master and with the master and be with the master alone. And that's where you have no problem. I never had any problem in any community. I just mix with them. I love them, but I don't see them. You understand? I'm not disturbed. How can I be? I'm too occupied. I'm too occupied inside. When I was in India, I was in an ashram for a few months. And when I first came, I just help around, you know, washing dishes, anything. Anything I need to do, and I have time, I do it. And most people don't like washing dishes, washing floor and that. And so I do all these things. And even if the one who work in the office don't need to do the labor work. But when I work, I finish my office so fast and I saw everything laying around, I don't like mess, so I clean it up and I do it very fast. I know how to organize things. You know, the mountain of dishes like this. So I went in the kitchen, all I see is dishes. So now there are big tanks or big washing dishes place. So I put them all, soap and water running into it, and then I put all the dishes inside, okay, soak it for a while. And then the other side, I run cleaning water. And after I put it out, it's a little bit clean already. It's clean already. So I just shake a little bit, and then put it all inside there. And then later I dig them up, and then one by one, they're clean by themselves. I leave water running. But the problem is Indian water. sometimes not. Just like magic, you know. Now you see them, now you don't. So sometimes to wash dishes is a real enlightening problem, enlightening question to be solved. So you see, that's how I pass my time. I only remember washing dishes, nothing else that happened. So that's what it is. Okay, that's how I pass my time. And I wear just like Indian Punjab, you know, just similar to this. Nothing very special, not even so beautiful like this. And the because I didn't have that much money, when you travel and you don't work, you know, you have to take care of everything, penny. You cannot afford to wear luxury. So I have only 3 pair of clothes. And the cotton I wear is the cheapest in India. And even Indian people don't wear this kind of, just like cheesecloth. But I like it. It's soft, it's airy, and it's cheap. So I make 3 pair of that, and that's finished, nothing else. And so I'm nothing special from anyone else. But all around me is Indians and Americans. Or I mean European American. But I never feel that I'm not at home with them. Maybe because I speak languages. I speak French with the French, I speak German with the German, I speak English with Americans. So, and the Indian people, they speak English too, most of them. Therefore, no problem, you see. I never feel that they are different from me. I never had any idea. I don't even think of the differences. I don't even know that it exists. So when I see you, I know you are different from me, but it never occurred to me that you should be any different from me at all. Otherwise, I would feel distant, you know. I don't. I feel at home anywhere. So that's what the attitude we should have. After I left that ashram, because I stay one after another sometimes, you know, when I have nothing to do, you have nothing to do, you go around shopping for master, hunting for saints and Buddhas. Yeah, so I go from Sikhs and Hinduism and anything, you know, anybody is my friend. So right. So after I left that, and I come back next time, I went to Himalaya and come back, and one of the person in that ashram, he's supposed to be elders, you understand, one of the elders, the initiate from the previous master even. So he's kind of equal with this present master, the successor. But then he bowed to me. His beard was so long and white. His turban is so dignified, he's tall and massive and so saintly looking. And he bowed out to my feet. And I was sitting there reading newspapers. If I was sitting there cross-legged and closed my eyes like this, and he bowed to me, it would be understandable. But I just sit on the floor, squat, next to the telephone booth even. And just nothing to do, so I read the old Indian throw away on the dustbin newspaper. And then he bowed to me, the full prostration, the Indian way. Touch my feet, kiss my feet. Can you imagine? So I run away from that ashram. And you know, if you know the Indian tradition, you would appreciate the grave significance of this matter. Because he's the one who worked in the office of that present master, you understand? And he is the previous initiated, you understand? He could be my grandmaster in that case, you understand what I mean? The great master, before this present master. Everywhere you go, that person is your master in the ashram. Otherwise, if you don't accept it, you cannot stay there, you understand? So in a sense, you are the disciple of that present master. And that person is just like your master also. Because he was initiated by the same master with that master. So in the way, he's my master also, uncle master, you understand, hierarchy. Yeah. But also, I used to work with him also, together in that office sometimes, answering letter or doing some clerk work. And he didn't bow to me before. And he know me, you know, I'm one of the numbers in the ashram, or one of the foreigners who visit, you know, and who so-called disciples in the ashram. He know me, not that the first time he saw me. We worked together for many months in there, drinking tea together. But when I came back from the Himalaya, he bowed to me. And I was so scared.
Oh?
I was thinking, huh? I was scared that my ego will rise up like a mountain. So I go away from the ashram. Hmm. And it's not the first time, and it's not the only thing that happened. I have some disciples in India. they run around looking for me. And they look at my palm and say, oh, you're definitely the Buddha. Oh, please accept me as a disciple. On the spot. You understand? Just like that. But they're lovely. Oh, I like them so much. They are very pure, you know. So pure. Very innocent. Most of them. Like in any country, but majority of people are very innocent. Very saintly by nature. Very saintly. So therefore, when you go to India, it's difficult to not to like them. The Indian, if they bow to one master, they never should bow to another master again. Let alone, I am just one of the foreign disciples and just came for a few months. You understand? And he is the previous great master's disciple. And then the master passed away, another master passed away, and this present master, he's a three generation ahead of me, understand? And he bowed to me. And in front of my other people. Indian custom, very strict, you know, bending, huh? You know, huh? If you bow to another master, just like you commit a terrible crime. And this man is in full sense, understand? He's in full awareness. He worked for the present master, of the three master he worked for. Very tried and trusted. I'm very enlightened.
Didn't he want to follow you?
No, he didn't say anything, and I dare not ask. Do you think I still have my wit intact to ask him about anything like that? Yes.
I was going to ask if there was any dialogue between you two.
No, not at all. Not at all. I think I'm as stolid as anyone else around him. I don't pursue things when it's gone. I have no idea what to do, understand? When things come, things go. I didn't have any idea like you, so clear like this, what to do or to ask or to inquire about things. I inquire about nothing. If it comes to me, it comes, it doesn't come, it doesn't come, huh? Yeah? It's like that. And even, I don't go and look for master even, I just go around. People say to me, oh, there's another master, 420 years old, another one 500 years old, etc. And then I just go. They take me around, understand? Sometimes. Just by arrangement, natural arrangement. I don't inquire much things.
It makes you more human.
Yeah, that I don't know.
Yeah,
right.
Don't
so
know.
Now you make sure that you know I'm human. And don't take all nonsense from them, that I'm superhuman, okay? Yeah, it's fun to talk about these things. I was so surprised, and I didn't think anything about it, except to stay away. So in America, a similar thing happened. the people who, I don't know, they get vision and they go to the temple. I went to the temple where I stay and supposed to be the disciple. You know, wherever I am, I'm disciple. I don't think anything. You understand? I just do what is there and I stay where a circumstance has arranged. I don't think anything. Who is a master? Who is not this master? I never care. I had no idea that I would be master.
That's how you feel when you're a master? Become a master, you don't know that...
I don't know anything. Oh. I'm just forced and pushed, kicked out. I run away from India, that ashram, and then I met another Indian, and they chased after me all the same. And I run away from that place, and then I went to China, and they chased after me all the same. And I run away from China, I go to America, they chase after me all the same.
And all this time you didn't know you were a master?
No, I didn't know. What do I know? What for? What is a master anyhow? I am always a master. How should I know that I'm a master when I'm always a master? Understand? You cannot be aware that you are married when you, since you're a child, you are already married. You cannot always carry on, I'm Mary, you know, I'm Mary, my name is Mary so-and-so, I'm sure, I'm aware, I'm very positive, because I am this Mary. You cannot, you know you're Mary, but that's it, very vague, very innocent. Same with me. Same with me. I have no certificate. But I know for sure that I'm not what I think I am. I'm not the this and that. I'm not that idea. I'm not this desire. I'm not that. Understand? That body. That I know. But since you think I'm a master, and since everybody knows that I'm the master, and since people are more number than I am, I lose. So you win. Yeah? The majority always wins. Everybody calls me master, so what? That's it. Okay, finish.
But you know you're a supreme master, you told us.
Well, I know. I know, but I don't know. Oh. You know you're Mary, but you don't know you are Mary. No? You don't always carry that Mary-ness with you. Huh?
Yes.
Very natural. You just be it.
Yes.
Huh? Understand or not?
Yes.
I'm a master. I don't need to know. I don't want to know. Why should I know? If I'm a master, I can only eat twice or once a day. The same thing. I can only sleep when I'm tired. It's the same like everyone else, even if the most beautiful clothes. I can only reach up to that much. Free yourself. Free yourself. Enjoy what God gives you. And if He takes it away, all right. Then you don't need it anymore. Less burden. Okay? The less desire, the better. The less burden, that's all. But should what God give you, then take it. There was a king. There was a man in India. His name is Rama. And when he's supposed to be the king, all right, and he prepared to be the king. But afterwards, some of those, lousy officers in the court say something bad about him to his father, and his father dismissed him. Yeah? I don't want to make him king anymore and drove him out of the kingdom. Oh, it's a very funny story. Yeah. Her son was a very loyal to this Rama because probably he was also a master. Not only the king but the master himself. Yeah. So he was a kind of disciple of Rama. So he was so devoted to him that even he was a king but he never sat on that throne. He put the Rama's shoe on the throne to represent that he's only looking after the throne for him. That he is not the king. Understand? The stepmother's son. Despite all this, he never take the throne. He always respect the real king. So Rama, when he was having a kingdom, he's all right, he prepared for it. And when he was taking away the kingdom, he's also the same, happy. He said, okay, then I have less responsibility. Good for me. So he just went away. So for him, a palace is like, just exactly like the cave that he found in the Himalaya mountain where he retreat, or where he was driven to exile. Yeah. He makes no preference. He is happy wherever he is. That's the right attitude for a practitioner. If something good given to you and you don't eat, you keep staying there and mouth watering. What is the use of that? What is the use of that? You waste your mouth water only. And you still not cut the desire to the root. Understand? Everything is God's gift. If you take it, all right. If you don't take it, it's all right. No one is holier than the next. Eat when you're hungry, sleep when you are tired. Same apply to every other thing. And free yourself. Because you are most precious. You are the most lovable person. You deserve the most respect, the most care, the most attention, the most holy position, everything. You house God. Understand? No one else and nothing else is more precious than you. It's very comfortable when somebody loves the others in just such a way, you know, very unconditional, unbinding. Just feel very much close and but don't need to bind with each other. As true love is always like that. We feel very close to each other. We don't need to be together. Yeah. This is the best way.